wish to thank each and every one of you all. I'm just getting off of a 10-hour flight from New York, so just bear with me.
Спасибо всем большое, что вы пришли. Вы должны меня понять и немножко даже простить, потому что я только что с самолета, 10-часовой перелет и все такое.
I would like to introduce you to guys.
Азат Баязитов и Алексей Жуков, пожалуйста.
Надо сказать, что у нас нету каких-то конкретных заготовок, мы просто пришли попробовать поиграть и, может быть, задать несколько вопросов мистеру Картеру.
Me either. Everybody's improv.
Вы вместе играете, так? Вдвоем.
And let him get some of that at the end.
Дай ему доиграть.
Share.
Играйте вдвоем. Делите правильно.
Okay. And then you support him.
Потом поддерживаешь.
One more game.
Da da da. Yeah.
Standards. Standards will never die. And the reason why I think it's very essential that we deal with standards is for the eternal themes that they represent. Far too often nowadays, music seems to not really have an eternal meaning, you know, with the bling bling and all the other, you know, materialistic things that go on, particularly in like hip hop and whatnot. And I'm not saying that there isn't any meaning to it, but as far as something that people can identify with across the line, like this tune, there'll never be another you. I mean, there's a whole lot to be said in that title, you know, and it screams individualism to me, you know. Anybody say, okay, one beginning for that. One, Okay, that's one way. One, two, I mean, it's something that you're able to play around with and to identify with, and also you can either, you know, pap it around, or you could rhapsodize it, you know, just and everything in between. And in doing so, that gets you in touch with what's happening here.
С этой музыкой вы можете сделать все, что угодно. Можете ее сыграть легко. Можете как бы изнутри вывернуться, продемонстрировать все ее грани. Но в любом случае, вы... В любом случае, это именно вы демонстрируете свою душу и то, что вы вкладываете в эту музыку.
I got this to say that this could be music. You know, notes, chord changes, you know, all on paper, everybody's going like but sometimes,
yeah,
you can be on the ground. Then where are you? When that happens, you got to come back to here. You know, you have to come back to the human qualities of it. And last time I checked, it was humans that were making music. You know, it wasn't all about computers. And if it was about computers, it still took humans to program them. So, with that being said, try to listen to each other a lot more. When you're in a jam session-like situation, their ideas, you know, just like in a tennis match, that could be batted back and forth, you know. Like, let's play some eights, for example. Just the three of us. One, two,
Thank you.
Experience the players, not just play what's on the page, you know. That way the music becomes more organic, yeah. More organic, and everybody feels involved because, oh, I played that, and he's, you know, he's bouncing off me back and forth. Everybody feels more involved, and that influences and inspires other things to happen, spontaneously, yes. Let's take another tidbit, if you will. That body and soul we talked about. Yeah.
Thank you.
Once again, the classics, for me, it's always a reminder of not only of where I've come from, where we can still go, but just the relevancy that all these tunes, you know, provide for us. You know, they provide safe havens, but at the same time, there's so many other places you can go with them. I mean, dang it. If I can get this to, okay, there we go. This is because every time that jam session situations and instances like this comes about, it always reminds me, it's always something else to practice, you know. So I'm not exempt from that, you know, and none of the other cats are exempt from that. And in talking with Sonny Rollins recently, I mean, here's a guy that's in his 80s and he's still looking for things, you know. So I'm only barely half his age, and you know, I have no excuse. We all have no excuse. If they're able to look, then we should be able to seek as well. You know, Moody, James Moody, up until his last, you know, his last breath, he was always, you know, looking for something. I can share many a fine story on that when I was out on tour with him in 2004. But just forever searching and always keeping his ears open. And when he wasn't able to play his tenor anymore, he transferred all of his energies over to flute until he couldn't play that anymore. And then when that happened, then he made his transition. But that just goes to show, as long as he was able to, he was able to play. in one form or another. And if he wasn't able to do that, he was always listening to something hip and saying, "Oh, I could have did that," you know. So just continue, you know, study the music and be true to oneself, and that's about it, you know. I mean, there's gonna be haters and folks, "Oh man, you playing all this other stuff," you know. But that relationship's between your creator and you, and what he endows you with, and you have to be true to what that endowment is, regardless of anybody else, because they weren't in on that. What say you?
Thank you. Thank you. Джеймс, спасибо за музыку. Я вот на протяжении 10 лет изучаю ваши композиции, ваше соло, и у меня вопрос, как вы добиваетесь легкости в динамике от пиано к фортиссимо, от фортиссимо к пиано, и это все в балансе в инструменте? Какой секрет?
The secret.
Вот такой секрет.
Let us see here. That's the secret.
Вот это и есть секрет.
The moonstone, the mouthpiece.
Именно мундштук.
Back in America, there was this thing called, the railroad. It was east meets west, okay? And there was this golden spike that was put in the middle where east finally did meet west. And for me, that equivalent is me being east and this being west. This is the spike that's in the middle. This is what communicates or externalizes what I'm hearing here. What I feel here and what my body can do. This is actually an appendage. This makes this an able appendage of what it is that I'm feeling that I can do. If you don't have a right mouthpiece, it's going to choke up on you, and there's certain things that you won't be able to do. So the secret is being able to go to a music shop or go online and trial mouthpieces, and it's going to take a while, but the results are very, very rewarding. I was very fortunate to come about Lawton mouthpieces, which is the main mouthpiece that I've been playing since 1988, and I started out on baritone playing it, and then by way of the late Julius Hemphill from World Saxophone Quartet, I got my soprano, alto, and tenor, and I had the whole family and started playing Lawton's ever since then. So, and I've noticed that everybody tries, but you can't beat great craftsmanship, and in that craftsmanship comes the power, the balance, everything that I can hear up here, and things that I have yet to hear, I'm still able to do. So I'm able to take one mouthpiece, because back in the day I had like 3 mouthpieces for this horn, 2 mouthpieces for baritone, 3 mouthpieces for soprano, 3, and it was but to be able to put it all in one mouthpiece, to be able to go
thank you.
so forth. But this is the secret. If you want to call it a secret, it's just finding your mouthpiece. You find your mouthpiece, then you find that outer appendage that enables the horn to do what you want it to do.
Что за мушту?
What's the mouthpiece?
It's Lawton. Lawton was made in Macclesfield, England. By now, the late Jeff Lawton. He passed in October 2003. I think he was one of the first individuals that I really knew about that made mouthpieces from single bars, you know, as opposed to auto links where they would make halves and fuse them together and then finish them up later. He made his mouthpieces from a single bar of whether it was bronze in this case, gold-plated bronze, or stainless steel, hard rubber, just gold-plated brass. And I think as a result of that, there's more integrity to the mouthpiece, and I think it gives you more opportunities, if you will.
Which model of
This one is an 11 star double B. So I go back and forth between 9, well, 10, 11, 12, depending upon what the fancy, you know.
Small with
the big buffalo. Fairly, yes. They're becoming collector's items now that Lawton's passed. If you find one, and it's definitely from Jeff as opposed to his son Jason, who now heads the firm. I like Jason and all, but I've seen some of his work, and it's not his dad. His dad took the craftsmanship to the grave with him. He didn't pass that on to Jason at all. I see that there's some things that he's a lot better at, but I've seen some mouthpieces where the side rails are uneven and the tips are, you know, oh God, no. Who's this? You know, who did this? No, no. But if you're able to find an original Lawton and it works for you, snatch, you know, seriously. Because they will be with you for quite a while, you know. And the thing about it is when you do get one and you start really playing along with it, it really becomes a part of you, you know. And it also helps you to stand up, and you got to put yourself into it. It's not one of them easy mounties. You actually got to give something in order to give back. So it's really a live thing. And while we're on equipment, I must say that I've been dealing with P. Moriot since 2006. And this is exclusively, and it's not a paid thing where I'm up here going like this, like, yeah, I'm playing Pete Moriot, and then you see me at a concert and I'm playing like Selmers and Kings and stuff like that. No, I've literally been playing and recording with them since 2006, you know, and I feel that this company is a very great company that listens to players and they implement, you know, whatever ideas that they give to the company. Big case in point was the soprano. My first soprano that I had was a P, what is it? This Model 64, an early Model 64. And I was playing at the Newport Jazz Festival. And I got into playing this and it went there, you know, and couple pads came out, a roller, and the left-hand thumb rest came out on the floor, and everybody's like, wow, he's blowing the horn, look at Crocky, look at him. Stuff was falling, and the thing went out of, it went out of alignment, so it was, you know, and I can't do nothing with this. And I told him about it, because everybody in the audience thought it was part of an act, that the horn was falling apart, but it wasn't. The only thing I was short of doing was going like this, you know, like it was a, you know, the Who concert or something like that. But, you know, the next horn that they gave me, the intonation was a lot better, was a lot more sound. And then I wound up with this model not too long afterwards, and even a bit more stable. And just recently, I started checking out the one-piece soprano, which is a lot more stable in the lower end for some reason. It can take a lot more air than the detached necks for some reason. It's real weird, but seriously. And I'm also in the process of designing my own signature model, which is a one-piece curved neck, similar to the Yamaha's 62Rs from back in the day. So we're using that as like the template, the Moriart bore, and the ergonomics from Yanagisawa, Yamaha. It's all mixed up in there, and it's a good hybrid, great axe. It should be coming out pretty soon. So I've been dealing with the peas.
Скажите ему, чтобы учел, что у нас пальцы короче.
Russians have small fingers.
You get around.
Please, special models will be for Russia.
Oh, no, it'll definitely work. Universal, all over the board. Be able to play it like that, even. Just put the nub on it like that.
Джеймс, скажите, пожалуйста, пару слов о технике игры слэпом на баритоне.
What's called slap techniques using baritone? Slap techniques. The first saxophone that was ever made was what? Anybody?
Прототип какой-то.
Деревянный.
Да, что-то какое-то экспериментальное.
Кларнетом.
The first saxophone that was made was the bass saxophone. And I'm saying this to say the fact that tone production was a bass quality where you had more of a percussive sound on it. So when you listen to like, let's say like early 20s recordings like with Fletcher Henderson, Benny Moulton's band, and you hear the guys, that's basically what it is. I mean, that's the common way of playing it, but this is just a more sarcastic way. Instead of going, it's just cutting it in half, you know, and then playing around with the cavity, if you will. I mean, you could go. And just think bass wise, you know. And that's the main thing that goes on in my mind, just thinking bass and what would a bass player do. That just put you in there cool. And once again, this goes back to, because if you have a small setting, a small facing, weak reed, that's what's going to happen. But if you have a large enough setting, large enough facing, hard enough reed, where you can do those extended things, but at the same time, you still have to retain the bass qualities of what makes this instrument possible. Still be able to and everything else, you know.
А какие трости вы подобрали для мустука?
What reeds to use for this?
Basically, I've had a good fortune with Ricoh plastic cover and also the old brown box Ricos from back in the day, the old V cuts that are usually 25 a box. They look like a brownish sort of color. Those are great reeds whenever I find them. They're usually old stock from like the 50s, early 60s, you know, but mainly plastic covers. Because of the coating, black reed, they're not synthetic like this. I find that synthetic reeds, I've played a couple of times, and I play them and the tip will come off like a hangnail, and I caught one back here, one never again after that. So the plastics I really don't go for, because not only they're a hazard, but they don't have a heart like wood where they can bend, and they sound really, they have this sort of sound, there's no core.
Есть такое явление «эндорсмент». В России всегда, когда заходит речь о таком явлении, первым номером упоминают Джеймса Картера. Скажите, пожалуйста, что дает вот эндорсмент музыканту?
Well, I can speak for myself. Endorsing an instrument or a product, I feel... an artist should be 100% behind. If you looked at my discography, my CDs, with present tense, it was the very first time that I've ever able or even featured in liner notes or in my artwork, specifically one horn brand. I mean, I've never done it with anything else. I think the closest thing that I might have done that on was Gardenias for Lady Day, and those were two Selmer saxophones that I didn't even play on the recording. I played Yamahas on that recording, with the exception of the baritone. That was a project horn that I refurbished. But endorsing, I feel that when I endorse an instrument, I feel that it has potential to express my voice. If it doesn't have it now, it'll certainly have it later. It has the key elements, good metal, good key work, things of that nature that enable me to externalize what I'm feeling, what I'm hearing. You know, it's not just a, okay, we'll pay you to do this and, you know, just say this, say that, show like, no, there's none of that. It's not a Kenny G situation where you see, you know, the new Kenny G model and, you know, and all that, but then you go to his concert and he's back to playing the song. No. I play these horns. I record with these horns, you know. So it's not just a paid thing. And also... give them feedback and helping to design the next models that are coming, you know. So it's the very first time that in my life that I've fully gotten behind one brand, you know, not just saying I play them, but I also help design them as well. So that's why my name keeps coming up, I think. I've been with them, like I said, since 2006, and they've been around pretty much since 2003, 2004. So, almost since the beginning.
Yeah. Какой баритон он предпочитает, короткий или длинный? Потому что в фильме он играет на коротком. А я не знаю, выпускает поле говоря короткий баритон.
You mean low B flat, low A?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
I prefer one that's working. I think
для меня это две большие разницы по звуку.
Oh, big difference, yes. I think from an early standpoint, in school, you've always had the low B flats, you know, for the most part. When I finally saw a low A, and I was like, wow, look at it, it's got that extra note on this lock letter, you know, and it's like, wow, look at it, you know, and hearing it, there's a big difference between, you know, And finally, and then putting that thumb down there, oh, it was like, yeah. It's like you've arrived. It's like it's a professional instrument, you know. And I think it's received that stigma, you know, since then. You know, it's all professional instrument. Now that you got that extra note on it, so, kind of like with the flutes, with the low C and the low B, you know, it's that same thing. You have that that extra note on there, and it's like, yes, I've arrived. I'm a professional now, you know. And they definitely vibrate differently, you know. Particularly if you have like a con, a low B flat con. I mean, there's no beating that. The majesty of the sound that low B flat has on that con. But I find that if you adjust the keys to the point where you can open them up a bit more, because on these instruments, well, that's not bad, but usually they have them like really close to like right here, and you have to cut the corks in order for them to come open, because if they don't, then it's like, I have quite a few old Cowards from late 50s, early 60s, and I've taken them completely apart, and there's one that I've put like solid brass dome resonators in and opened up the keys just a little bit more, and it gets real close to that con low B flat sound where none of the bell keys are stuffy, you know. That's always been a thing about these, is in terms of finding that balance where you're still able to get around on the horn, but where it's open enough to have every one of these bell keys sing individually, as opposed to the only strongest note being the low A, because everything else is closed. Because back in the day, it used to be like, but now it's a bit more balanced because they've opened up the keys a lot more, so that the note preceding it can breathe a bit more and be a lot more fuller. Yeah. Yeah. We're working it out. Yeah.
One question. Вы один из тех, кто играет то, что называется straight-ahead jazz, not smooth jazz. Так вот, джаз активно развивался в 40-е, 50-е, 60-е годы. Что вы можете сказать о перспективах джаза как музыки, как направления музыки? Способен ли джаз развиваться? Вот тот джаз, который мы называем straight-ahead jazz.
I think it's always developing and improving, you know. The key factor is, I mean, we've talked and played standards, but what I'm imploring is not resting on the laurels of those standards. And I mean, when we played Body and Soul, I didn't go back to October 11th, 1939 and, you know, reference Coleman Hawkins, you know. I mean, for me, jazz is the original swagger. I mean, everything that you see out here now that's come about after jazz that has a certain attitude or a sense of verve, or, you know, I mean, from R&B, jump blues, rock and roll, all that came from jazz. I mean, Motown definitely came from jazz, because those were jazz musicians that were in the studio, and they were coming directly from whatever concerts that they were doing, and they were bringing the flavor of those concerts in on those particular sessions, where all of a sudden you hear a rumba, which was performed before for a shake dancer by the name of Lottie the Body. They brought that into the Motown sound and incorporated it. All this came from jazz musicians. So there's always room for not only acknowledging that, but also taking that knowledge and running with it in whatever genre you're in, you know. I find that because of that, I'm able to play and verse myself in different areas, you know, smooth jazz and otherwise, if I choose to. But at the same time, unlike some other smooth jazz players that only play a particular like wee doo wee doo wee doo wee doo, all that, you know. I'm coming from a different standpoint where you can hear a bit of vocality in my playing, or you can hear the electric aspect in my playing when I go into extremes or whatever, and everything in between. I don't think that one should look at jazz music as dead or standstill or arrested development or whatever those terms that you wish to put on something that's stored, you know. I don't look at it like that. I'm very thankful for the practitioners that have come before us. And just like with classical music, I mean, you don't look at folks saying that about that, about classical music, and things are being repeated, you know, when you think of Mozart's, you know, the Requiem and Hindemith, and, you know, everybody's playing it the same way that the, you know, the composer intended, and no flack's being said about that, you know. What if they added a bridge onto the Marriage of Figaro, and all of a sudden we're going over here? Would there be anybody saying anything about it then? Yeah, probably so, but, you know, the point is that it's still a classic, just like the tunes that we were playing and many others are classics as well. We should adhere to them, learn from them, and grow from them.
Чего не хватает современным саксофонистам, чтобы достичь самых высоких?
There's always the academic, you know, that's truly being stressed in institutions, and I think in most instances, as long as people meet their academic credentials, that they feel that they have their, you know, their cred, you know, their street cred and all that, but there's still that human element that that enables you to get into lyrics, you know, at least put yourself in more situations that are really kin to you, like play with more vocalists. I find that I have a real good joy in playing with a great vocalist because being able to have that rapport, you know, where I'm able to coexist and not step on her toes and still get my meaning out from the same tune that she sings, you know. Because the vocalist immediately is the Mac because they have the spoken word as their weapon, whereas we have to imply that with the ha hee ha hee. She can say me, and I'll be like me, you know. So immediately the vocalist is the Mac, so I have to be in service of that Mac and take what I can out of it, and when it comes time for me to be that soloist, incorporate that that vocality in my playing whenever I need to. And just the art of being fearless, you know, it's you know, really missing. I think we can do a whole lot of things that are safe, but sometimes certain things that are unconventional, or certain techniques or whatever that are unconventional, aren't being employed that could set that individual apart from their contemporaries. Yeah. And that. Yeah. I must say that I don't believe that it's a loss, you know, a lost cause, because the reverse of that is nobody could be listening or playing at all. So it doesn't even have to be in a school. But I think that what you learn academically should act as a catalyst to help you go out and get everything else. It shouldn't be the end in itself. Like, okay, I've graduated with a degree in jazz musical performance. I have a master's in it, but, you know, but it's under the institutions, you know, auspices that you garnered this. It wasn't out in, you know, at a jam session or at somebody's house where you're playing, or, you know, on the bandstand with a mentor or a serious guru, you know, and that's where the stripes are really, you know, earned. So it's just a matter of making that choice and saying that, okay, if I'm in school, then that's not the end in of itself. You know, this is just spurring the interest along, sparking it so that when I do meet these heroes and, you know, people of the like, I'll be further inspired to, you know, shoot even higher beyond the page, beyond the books, you know, beyond what's at the institution, and be more culturally aware as well.
Как играть аккорды на саксофоне?
Да тут уже две чёрные
пары.
Аккорды.
Yeah, I understand.
Ears. A long time ago, I made a mistake. And I had an old horn, and I went to go finger a particular note, and my finger went in between two keys, closed one key and opened up another key simultaneously, and all of a sudden this just came out, and I was like, oh, yo, you know, it's like, wow, so I need to do that. So come to find out, there was a term for it that was called multiphonics. Of course, multi meaning multi, you know, many, and sounds. There's one way of just making a bunch of sounds come out of one air column, and then there's another way of making it comprehensible to make it theoretically make sense. You know, for example, listening to choral instruments such as guitars, piano, violins, when they're able to do those double stops, you know, and just incorporating them. Thank you. Я просто знаю, как приблизительно, как они. Мне просто не нравится, как стиль игры. Но я так приблизительно понимаю, как это нравится. Мне нравится более чистое звучание. Мне нравится стиль Дон Байса. Но?
Of course. I definitely dig Bias. I feel he's one of the most underrated individuals that ever came out of Western music. And incidentally, it's his. This would have been his 100th year of his birth. Born in October 1912, and
if you look once again through discography, I've always had tunes of his, and I've always slipped one in every now and then in my discography, like on JC on the Set, Worried and Blue, Real Quiet Storm, 1944 Storm. I did a whole program of his that I called Living My Life Music, Life Music of Don Bias, in which we started as the a duo between tenor and bass, sort of like the 1945 Town Hall with him and Slam Suit, that sort of thing. And then from there went into trio, quartet, quintet. And finally, the Concertgebouw Big Band with Faye Clausen, and you know, we're all there. But, so, no Bias is a bad cat. The main thing that I get from him, not only the tone, but his harmonic conception that pretty much belied his years. I think he was the next logical step from Hawkins in terms of that. And he was always that bridge between him and Train, you know, because you could hear where he was using the neighboring tones. And he basically got that from Art Taylor. I feel that, you know. When you listen to, like, things that he does on, like his Stardust, for example. I mean, play Stardust. E flat minor. B flat. D.
Thank you.
this is what Bias would do, or what he's done.
Thank you.
Once again, it comes from listening to other instruments. Just like we mentioned just now about listening to chordal instruments for the basic chordal, I hate using the word effect, but just listen for chords or multi-tones that imply a particular chord. Also listen to them for various other things like think about B.B. King, like same thing goes for tonguing. I mean, you think about At least I think about like flautists or trumpeters, you know, and in the methods that they employ, like tika 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 for double, tika 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 for triple, tika 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 tika. That's all it is. The ta is actually the touch. The ka is the reverse.
Ka, you don't touch the ring. When you say ka, you don't touch
ta-ka.
The ring.
Yes,
sir.
Any other questions? Well, I just want to say in closing, I'm very grateful for the gift of music and for the saxophone coming into my life. I didn't choose the saxophone. I feel that throughout my life, the saxophone chose me because of the various ways that it exposed itself to me. And as a result, I've been able to make, earn a living. It's because of this instrument that I have the family that I do have, and it's because of this instrument that I'm in front of you all right now. So I'm very grateful to it, and I'm always grateful to the forebears, and you know, I always wanted to keep that at the helm of whatever I do musically and artistically and socially, and I want to thank each and every one of you all for coming out. Hopefully we'll be able to see some of you all tomorrow at the Tchaikovsky Hall and subsequent hits later on. So peace and blessings. Thank you all very, very much. Thank you all. Thanks.
Последний маленький-маленький вопрос. Каковы ваши впечатления о русской зиме и о нашей столице?
This is the second time I've been here, and it's always been during the winter, and I dig it. It's like being back home, because I'm used to below 30 degrees, you know, 30 degrees below zero, and, you know, coming from Michigan, you know, that's how we roll, where you can go like, hey! And the little thing, hey, stays like there like a thought cloud, and then all of a sudden, but no, it's, the air is real crisp, and you know, it's great, continues to be. I don't think I'd know how to react if I was here during the summer.
JP,
solo
JP.
JP.
Who? Please.
Oh God. You see, I don't even remember that.
Thank you.